All right, here we are.
Got a little bit of nipple on the napple. Got a little bit of nipple on the napple. Put a couple birds on that.
Thank you.
This lesson is
to be able to smoothly move from octave to octave. And that takes memory of knowing where all the notes are, especially if you just want to shred. 15, 20, 30 years can pass by before you realize, okay, well, I don't have to shred, now I don't have to move octave to octave. You start wanting to orchestrate music. You start wanting to compose. You don't want to compose, but compose spontaneously.
Huh? Huh, you weren't impressed?
Why? because it's something that had to be written down on paper to be remembered how to play. Think about that. Let that soak in while you're studying private maritime law, while you're transferring in this mind shift to have everything written on our hearts. As friendly as I can. Keep my female animal brain intact now.
Cool. You see how I did that? Now there's two types of melody. there is Skelotic Melody, and there is Melodic Melody. Skelotic Melody and Melodic. So ska and me are the two different types of melodies. Ska is scarier, like this. And then start going into me. You know that you've moved from ska, melodic melody, to me, or self melody, or melody of the gods. You know you've moved to me, melodic melody, when you add rest to our play. When we add rest to our play. That's all me, melodic. Me, Lottie, me, Lottie, not ska, Lottie, but me, Lottie, is based on making ourselves or entering into rest between the notes, or entering into rest between the intervals. Think about that. Gist of it, we were able to get the idea of how to rest our notes. Thank you.
Not only can you play the same melody on the guitar that you sing with the rhythm melody. Not only can you do that with the same melody, but like I said, you can play a totally brand new melody like this. You can also change which note of the arpeggio you want to land on. For instance, instead of an open G, like we're doing here, by the way, this is the key of G sharp. This is the number 5 box of the key of G sharp. Or laterally, it's the vertical, or the laterally, it's the number 6 box, which is the famous blues box. That one, back of the palm. So, not only can we be doing some pull-offs, simple pull-offs, not only can we pull off to the G, go to the G, but we say to ourselves, there's two other notes to that G arpeggio. All you gotta do is play a power chord for that, what they are. A full power bar chord. Chord is a D. Of course, that's the 5th. That G, that's just a regular 2-finger bar chord right there. You play that all day. I didn't do it like that, man. But for the most part, within the first 3 months or so, I think I caught myself in chord all the time. That's where I developed my full chordness all the time. You don't have to go exactly octave to octave with the same note. Each note is an arpeggio. An arpeggio is your choice of three notes. And like I said, just do a bar chord and figure out what they are. I change octaves to a different note in your arpeggio. And this is something that I've thought about in my mind for a long time, for at least 2 years. Now, same thing happened with drums. I didn't have a drum set for the longest time. But about 10 years ago, someone from church showed me how to play drums. It was easy. Imaginary symbol. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Kick on one. Kick. 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 Two. No. Kick. Two. Snare on 3, 4. Kick. 2, 3, 4. Kick. 2, 3, 4. Kick. So I practiced that in my mind. Every once in a while, maybe 3 or 4 times a year, I think about it. So it's like, whoa, I got a drum set, it's automatic. I've got my own drum set, and I got it. Same happened to me, because I did it 5. Point is, I'm saying, I've been thinking about this octave changing for the last 2 years, instead of going to the same note, different octave, go to one of the other notes on the arpeggio. This. How do they fit? Or it's one of the other notes of the arpeggio. Here's the arpeggio. That's it right there. G arpeggio. three notes in an arpeggio. And the key of G has to be a 1-3-5. So you can do all the math on that at home for your homework and all that. You can explain it here. There's too many vids on YouTube. There's plenty of vids on YouTube if you want to know what an arpeggio number is and all that. You can do the homework. A little bit of homework. I'm giving you some homework. See that finger of that formula out there? You just turn that to a palm down. Go do some homework, man. I watched my psychology and YouTube did palm down. Palms up. Down. No fingers. The finger is the control factor of the ego. It's a trait that expresses itself through things. Go do it. Go do it. You better do it or else. But it's also everything's a duality too. So the finger can also be a form of electricity, touching. It all depends on our vibration that we're emitting when we use the finger. Whether conscious or unconscious, a vibration is emitted. And that's a vibration of health or a vibration of foreclosure. Something foreclosure, by the way. So I can go octaves to the D now. The D, and then doing this lesson here, just sharing, since I'm sharing it here. I learned something from the King Diamond guitarist named, what's his name? But, those are backwards arpeggio, you know? Something like that, so. Guitarist who doesn't try to figure out exactly what people are doing. I just hear it with my ear and I make my own version. Developing now from muscle memory. G sharp, it's not going to be a D. I'm just playing the G. That's the G sharp. It's D sharp. B sharp and D sharp. And if you think about the B, the interval between B and D, between D sharp and B sharp, that would be the mix. Be the F sharp bass, the minor seventh of the key of G sharp. There's the B sharp. There's the G. Do that again. There's the G. There's the D sharp. There's the B sharp. D sharp. It's just a fourth interval away from the key of G sharp. This would be the Randy Rhoads song, but Memoirs of a Madman. That movement right there. Oh, that's what I was doing. I can't see. I can't see a G sharp into the key of D sharp by just moving that C sharp note up one note to D. Here's G sharp, number 5 box, or the number 6 blues box position, 3 notes for sure. That's the distinguishing note for the key. That's what distinguishes the key of G sharp from the key of D sharp. Otherwise, it would be sharpened. That's D sharp. That would be the key of D sharp. Key of G sharp would be flatten that note. Key of G sharp. Key of D sharp. And that's what got me doing this down here.
Why it sounds so much more orchestrated than
all the other players on the earth. Including myself. But sometimes, like I said, I'm sharing the patent with him. Anyway, Jim Austin, the only thing he's got going for him is he keeps pounding the fundamentals. That's all he's doing every time he's on stage, he's pounding the fundamentals. He's got the fundamentals so ingrained in his conscience and in his subconscious that he didn't even have to walk or play on stage. And he can just float around, jump around, skip around, hop around, throw the guitar around, which way but loose. And hit arpeggio, different arpeggio notes all night long. It sounds like, a real player. A real someone who's skilled on his instrument. Because that's all a violinist is someone who's skilled on his instrument. Because they know all that pretty, man. You go to a symphony and you start talking to people in the orchestra, oh man, watch out. They'll be able to tell you music inside and out. Especially if you go talk to the conductor. Yeah. Inside and out. Because he's constantly telling cello players, violinists, saxophonists, French hornists, and all the other instruments. No, you play this note of the arpeggio. You over there, you play that one. And you do the roll. You do the quick sporadic rolls. You play the ending note. And you play the different ending note. Oh yeah, they got this stuff all mapped out. Us guitarists, we just come on the scene. Guitar is something new here in the last century. Something new, man. So we're still developing, coming up to speed through the theory of music. So anyway, so there it is, man. I'll explain to you, that's my goal. I've been thinking about this for a couple of years now. I've been waiting for the motivation to train myself at doing it. I've had other things on my plate, such as private maritime law, which is much more important than learning music. But when you figure it out, it's all the same thing. Private maritime law and music is the same universal law. But signing myself out of prison plan to be able to create my own money. Or do have to eat, maintain food for his body at such time as morphine, and have the option of whether I want to eat or not, and maintain other different bodies. Is a number 7 arpeggio, so it doesn't follow that 1-3-5 combination. But you'll notice just one thing about the 7th note is we can make it either major or minor. That's the beauty of that number 7 note. We can make it major or minor, or we can keep it diminished. It has 3 options. Number 7 note is a powerful note. morph into three different segues, brothers and sisters, if you know how transmuted to be used to it music. This is where the harmonic minor note comes in. The seventh note, man. Where we get those diminished seventh arpeggio strings from the harmonic minor scale. Because it has that right there, that's that two space, two fingers, see? Two fret spaces. That's what the seventh note does for music. It gives us that diminished seventh.
Years in my life, but 5 years is just
hitting the notes clean as all. I'm still really practice on those, but you're good enough to see. Well, anyway, we were on that. We got on the number 7 note, but G sharp. So we take it up the octave and hit the G up there. To the D sharp, and then hit the B sharp, so as you can see, once we get progression at that, incorporated into our playing, make it a habit, make it muscle memory, it becomes efficient. And it starts sounding like some Yngwie Malmsteen stuff. It all of Yngwie Malmsteen stuff is just orchestrated music. And Randy Rhoads pretty much has a patent on bringing orchestration into music with heavy metal guitar, mixing both the acoustic and the electric guitar. Orchestration. He made parts of music sound like you are in a theater, and a movie, like a professional composer that actually composed music for a piece, for a scene. And when Ozzy sings, each phrasing or part of a song, like the verse from the chorus, the bridge, it is a scene. Randy Rhoads was able to bring that. And I could go in and study it out and show you examples, but I'm just telling you what I know. So that's what Randy Rhoads brought to us. And he composed on purposely written it down and all that. Playing the Soldier did something like that, but it wasn't as powerfully orchestrated the impact of the sound as the songs that Randy Rhoads were able to put together. On top of that, the songs that he put acoustically to, well, the electric acoustic guitar. There was like 2 songs that he did with that were on in the second album. Literally, the Memoirs of a Madman. And that was, the song Memoirs of a Madman, and I think it was S-A-T-O. Maybe a third of them, maybe 3 of them. He did 3 pieces. He brought that orchestrated orchestration, but like I say, it's all hidden within his single note playing. Like I said, he'll pull off a scale, he'll take the note up 2 or 4 octaves, and he'll hit and just string one note, but it will be the notes of the arpeggios that he's targeting out to land on. In this case, it would be a G. So now you can see the advantage of playing in the key of G sharp, and all of a sudden you get these new notes. There's still plenty of gold to be mined on the guitar, but all you have to do is start finding different mountains to start digging. That's where you find these mountains. You find these gold. You find the gold when you're playing different keys. You find different open strings and just like that. This one goes there. Pull them to the place of the notes. It just adds whole new texture to the playing. like I said, it's Monk and he orchestrates single-handedly. And he's up there playing guitar because that's all he has, is just that one guitar. Now, when Randy Rhoads got on stage, there was no way he was going to be able to get that same movement, same orchestrated effect as he did with the recorded stuff. He would have had to have three other guitars up there with him to pull it off. He was up there by himself. And they could have hired one of the guitars and made it happen, but they didn't. Well, they did that. Well, it will come back to me. It'll cycle back around. I'll get around to it. In fact, there's so many things that I discovered on the guitar, I just said to myself, oh, well, it'll come back around. There's plenty of time. I'll get around to it. And then I figured out I can go forever with my body right now. It's like, oh, shit. All that stuff's coming back around. From fret 18 to 20 on the first string. Yeah, I kind of give it that Eastern twang, you know, like the yogi. Thank you. So there's a verse to like you said, the sea.
Thank you. I got my little microphone here. This is my Radio Shack realistic mic. It's called the 33-3001. If you're ever interested, it's omnidirectional. Omni. All right, so it's an hour and 44 long minute video. This is going to take a while to upload, but we're going to make it happen. All right, talk to you later. Bye.